The Foundation Fighting Blindness and Two Blind Brothers present Music to Our Eyes, a Foundation Fighting Blindness music series featuring Grace Potter.
Good evening, everyone, and thank you for joining us for our third edition of Music to Our Eyes. My name is Jason Menzo, and I'm with the Foundation Fighting Blindness coming to you here from my home in Raleigh, North Carolina. I'm sitting here in my office where I spend most of my days on Zoom meetings, but tonight I'm actually sitting in front of my big Foundation Fighting Blindness logo. I've got my favorite acoustic guitar hanging in the background behind me, and I'm very excited to present tonight an exclusive concert and conversation with one of the most exciting performers touring today and someone with a very special connection to our mission, and that is Grace Potter. Tonight's show is being brought to you by the Foundation Fighting Blindness and is free of charge thanks to the generous support of our good friends at Two Blind Brothers. Be sure to check out their amazingly soft shirts, hoodies, socks, and more. You can even take the opportunity to shop blind through their Shop Blind experience. All of that at twoblindbrothers.com. And the best news yet, all the profits from Two Blind Brothers support our mission at the Foundation Fighting Blindness. And I'd also welcome you, if you feel inspired and would like to make a donation tonight to support our mission, be sure to click the button below or go to fightingblindness.org. So when tonight's guest first hit the scenes a number of years ago, she immediately became one of the most respected artists in the Americana music genre, which happens to be my favorite music genre, which is why I'm busting at the seams with excitement for tonight's show. She has collaborated with folks like Kenny Chesney and Jackson Browne, and has even been nominated for 2 Grammy Awards for her album, Daylight. I am so excited to welcome tonight's guest, Miss Grace Potter. Hi, Grace.
Hello, it's good to be here. Thank you for having me.
Our pleasure, thanks for joining us tonight. And I wanted to start, you know, we're in this sort of weird period of time right now where we're a year plus into the pandemic, but things are starting to open up. And 8 months ago, I had a conversation with another group here on Music to Our Eyes, the ex-ambassador, Sam and Casey Harris. And they talked about how during the pandemic, it forced them to focus as artists to sit down and write new music and create new content. I'm curious for you, I know you've done a lot of unique things during the pandemic as well, but what has your experience been like from a creative standpoint and creating new music?
I think when you lose the routine that you're in, which we all did, even if we created a new routine, it took a moment of adjustment. And my routine for 15 years of my life was getting in a tour bus and getting a crew of, you know, 10, 15, 20 people together, lights and fog machines and, you know, having this rock and roll experience where we really created like a moving village from one place to another. And, you know, that was my life, my reason for being. And so it was really strange when things, you know, everybody refers to it as the rug being pulled out from under them, which I think for people who are visually impaired, we know what that feeling is like. It is a really, really uncomfortable feeling. And so I kind of sat with it. I kind of leaned into the uncomfortable feeling of it instead of trying to grasp for it. And what came to me in the midst of maybe the first 2 or 3 weeks of the pandemic was some new music. I wrote a song called Each Other, which was really about just feeling the gratitude of the people that were around me, albeit it was a smaller group of people than I was accustomed to. But I also thought about this sort of traveling village that I had created in real life and how I might be able to establish something that felt like a community or a traveling village within our minds, especially our creative minds, because our imaginations are capable of incredible things. And so I really tapped into that and explored it. I'm not very comfortable working with the internet. I'm bad at the internet. I don't know if anybody's ever said that before, but I'm happy to be the first one. And I had to learn the tools to become a better communicator. And it connected me with my fans in ways I never imagined possible. Like I now have a list of songs in order based on the algorithms of the way that my fans responded to certain songs. and how it made them feel, where I have the data to acknowledge and be able to even communicate back with them. Which version do you like? You like it when I do it acoustic, on guitar, or on piano, or whatever? I mean, it was just a powerful experience of opening up the conversation much more and inviting a lot more people into that village.
That's really incredible. That's actually really interesting to, I don't want to say analyze, but to really learn the impact of your music in a quantitative way.
Yeah. Right?
So we usually think about music being very personal and how someone reacts to the lyrics or the music of the feeling of a certain song. But what I hear you saying is that it's more about, in this case, you learned about sort of in mass how people reacted to a particular song and versions and data. That's interesting.
It was collective in the same way that it can be at a concert. But where we felt disconnected, the music was the glue that was holding it all together, because everybody, as I'm sure you've experienced in these broadcasts that you've done, on the live streams you've done, that when you start to become part of something and people are all tuning their energy toward the same thing, there is this kind of collective consciousness that happens, and music just inspires that and pulls it out in people. I've always really enjoyed watching an audience move to my music, but it was really fun. You know, I guess in this case, it was more just the amount of responses that would come from one song versus another song. And then the next week I would do the same song, but it wouldn't get the same reaction. And it was often because of something as simple as they liked it better when I did it on piano or a cappella. So I'm going to explore that a lot tonight, I think, with the songs I'm going to perform. I'm going to turn them inside out for you guys a little bit.
That's sweet. That's really cool. You know, you mentioned the song Each Other that you recorded during the pandemic. And if I understand correctly, you recorded it with guest artists, but they were all sort of virtual. What was that experience like?
Yeah, I texted everybody. I had an audio file of just the demo of the song, and I just sent it to everyone that I thought would be an amazing contributor to the song. And happily, so many of these musicians that responded were exactly who I was hoping was going to contribute. Marcus King is an incredible singer, guitarist, and songwriter and creator. And Lucius, who had been on my album Daylight, but also are just the most incredible collaborators across the board in the music industry. They lent their voices. And then ultimately, Jackson Brown, who came in, brought the whole house down with the last verse of the song. And to hear my written lyrics sung by that iconic voice and that spirit and that human who I love and respect so much was... it would never have happened if it weren't for this lockdown. Mm-hmm. And it really felt like it needed to happen that way. And it was incredibly special. And then after that, we invited all of my fans to help collaborate and make the music video for it, which was a crowdsourced music video where I invited everybody in their own homes to additionally contribute and sing and perform. And so we worked all of our fan videos and everybody's voices into the ultimate music video, which we released in the fall.
It reminded me, and this is something you said just a few minutes ago, it reminded me of that moment in a live concert where the mic cuts out and just the bass drum is kicking and everyone's clapping and singing out in the audience. And it's that sort of, you know, interconnectedness of, you know, thousands of people, but this done in a virtual way.
Totally. The sing-along that needed to happen that couldn't happen in person, but I think everybody felt it. And in a more resounding way, because then they could watch the video and experience it over and over again, as opposed to just having it be this one finite moment. But live music does that for people.
Yeah, that's awesome. That was awesome. I wanted to ask you, you referenced something just a minute ago that I thought was probably such a personal and unique experience that only a small handful of people in the world have experienced, which is having their words performed or sung by a voice that they've looked up to. You mentioned Jackson Brown. I know that you've had probably experiences with others as well, you know, singing music that you've written. What is that like?
I think the first time it happened, where the sense of humility actually overwhelmed my memory that I had written the song. Like Willie Nelson sang one of my songs, Ragged Company. And there's a lyric in the song that's every town has a mirror and every mirror still shows me that I am my own ragged company. And when he sang it, I was not the songwriter anymore. I lost track of time and space. And as far as I knew, it was a Willie Nelson song. And, you know, that kind of thing happens a lot in life when you see something that you've created or a thought or idea that you have conjured. And when it's a really great idea, sometimes, and I don't know, maybe I'm the only one who feels this, but I think a lot of people do that have this experience where you kind of think it's already happened before. You have this feeling of mm-hmm. sort of deja vu. Like there's no way that this song hasn't been written because it's so familiar. It already feels like it's a part of me. And whenever I write a song, that's how I feel. But I think it's probably the same for the dude who invented the ice cube tray. You know, he was probably doing that being like, someone must have already thought of this, right? You know? I think it's important to realize that possession is not always 9/10 of the law. You know, like possession can just be that many, many humans are coming up with an idea or a solution to a problem at the same time. You know, I think the vaccine is a very good example of that as well, that many people were working on a solution to a collective problem that we were all experiencing together. And in this pressure cooker of the universe, it happens. So that's how it feels. That's a really long, deeply philosophical answer to your question.
It's amazing though. Yeah, it speaks to the fact that the performance, the actual end creation, I don't want to say product, it's a creation, the art that comes about is equal parts the word in equal parts the performance, right? So, you know, it became a Willie Nelson song in your eyes because it was part of what he contributed to that particular recording, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Well, this has been a joy so far. So thank you for this conversation up to this point. I wanted to just share with the audience and as you know, the Foundation Fighting Blindness, just a little bit about who we are, the organization putting this on tonight. We are the world's leading organization searching for treatments and cures for a variety of blinding conditions. And we do this by funding research all over the world. And just to put it in perspective, to date, we're actually almost 50 years old. We're an organization that started in 1971. We have fundraised and funded research to the tune of almost over $800 million in our lifetime. And actually just in the next 5 years alone, we're gonna be funding over $100 million of research. But we're also a leader in education, community engagement. We have local chapters and events all over the country. And I just want to remind everyone at home watching tonight that we, of course, can only accomplish this through the generosity of our donors and with the support of corporate sponsors and individuals like those watching tonight. So I just remind you again that if you're interested in supporting our mission, please be sure to click the button below or go to fightingblindness.org. And, you know, Grace, I wanted to turn it to you and get your perspective. So what do organizations like Foundation Fighting Blindness, why is what we do important? I know you support a lot of nonprofits, which is awesome, but why is this so important to you?
Well, I'm legally blind, and that's something very few people know, but it's a piece of my life and my story that I think has worked its way into my music. But also, when I pick my causes, when I pick my anything that I'm going to put my energy towards, it's usually because it's fueled my creativity. So if I have something creative to contribute, I don't want it to just be a random, like, oh, this seems like a nice thing to do. I really feel like when you have a soul connection to something, that it changes the way that the effect that can have on the overall community that you're speaking to. And so my outreach has always been focused on really coming from the heart. And it's impossible for this cause not to be close to my heart, because I know what it's like to not be able to see. My condition is not degenerative, but I was born legally blind and have handled and navigated my life in a way that has made it functional through the kindness, generosity, and resources that were offered to me through organizations much like this one. So I was able to take alternative tests when I was young and going through school. I was obviously not able to, you know, like fill in the little tiny holes for the multiple choice questions. I mean, that was completely beyond me. I was not capable of doing that. But through the experience of learning and being given access to resources that otherwise wouldn't be there, I found my confidence and I found an ability to be the person and the creator that I wanted to be.
That's beautiful. You know, part of the reason that we do this series is exactly what you just said. There's a young boy or a young girl right now watching this at home that knows your music, that loves your music, that looks up to you and had no idea that you were living the same life that they've lived or they are living. Yeah. I think of a young man, there's a young, awesome, really impressive young man, just graduated high school in St. Louis. His name is Jack Morris. And he's a musician, he plays a guitar. I'm sure Jack is watching tonight and saying,
"Hi, Jack.
Wow, I wanna be like Grace Potter," you know? Supremely talented, you know, authentic, you know, one of the best, you know, performing acts here on the scene today. So I know everyone is anxious to hear you play. So why don't we go ahead and kick things off? I'll just use this opportunity to remind everyone to check out our website at fightingblindness.org, where we've got a ton of information, details on events like what we have tonight and our vision walks and galas and all sorts of fun things. And even our brand new shop, Fighting Blindness, where you can pick up a t-shirt like the one I'm wearing right now, which says Vision Warriors. So that is at www.fightingblindness.org. And I will turn it over to Grace. So performing Fill Up Your Empty Heart is Grace Potter.
Together, then we're apart. Why won't you let me fill up your empty heart?
Yeah. You said earlier in the conversation, you know, you're a rocker. You are a rock and roll. I mean, like through and through. It's just awesome. Yeah. You touch a ton of musical genres, but I wanted to ask, you know, what is it like playing a song solo acoustic like what we just heard versus having the full band behind you? Like, how does that affect your approach to the song?
It changes the song. So to me, the song is completely different. I'm not thinking about the recording. I'm not even thinking about the last time I played it with the band, because the moment I do that, I'm already defeating myself in the conversation I'm having with the guitar, in the conversation that my body is having with my voice. I'm not able to go through the emotional process of loving every lyric and living in the moment of the song if I'm thinking about, oh, but I'm not doing that one part that usually gets played there. So I just totally, I pretend like the song is a dry erase board. I erase all the previous versions of it from my consciousness. And I just immerse myself in the song. And this, I can guarantee you that what you just heard right there is the only time that song will ever sound like that. For sure.
Well, everyone here tonight got an exclusive one night only experience with this, which is awesome. I wanted to, you know, there's a couple of topics I wanted to touch on. You know, we talked a bit about collaborations and other artists. You said even during, you know, the setup for the recordings you've done during the pandemic that you pinged a bunch of people, but like, how does that happen? You like shoot a text message? Like how do you get in touch with other artists to form a collaboration?
Well, it's very natural to get people's phone numbers. But I'm not actually an intuitive connector. You know, I'm more of someone who, if somebody gives me their number, then I have it. I can't believe the numbers that I have in my phone, though. And I think it really does come with just the amount of years that I've been on planet Earth. So, you know, there is a residual energy of like people knowing my name. And then we meet one time at, you know, Mavis Staples' birthday party in Chicago. There, because it was her 80th birthday and she knows everybody. So, of course, Mavis is one of the most incredible humans on planet Earth. So everybody showed up for her party, which was also a performance that we had a chance to do before the pandemic. And I met so many people. That was the night I met Michael McDonald. I met Glenn Hansard from The Swell Season and The Frames. I met, Robert Plant was there, but this was before we'd already met because we toured together. It goes on and on, but like, those are the kind of names when you have them in your phone. Like, how did I get Glenn Hansard's number? Oh, that night, Mavis. So I do believe that there are forces of nature that want people, creative people, to get together. And I think in doing that and just pinging everybody and sort of sending out that radio signal in the midst of what was really the first two very stressful weeks of the pandemic, it felt like an offering from the universe. And I became a part of that chaos machine. And I sent it out to the world. And I knew that not everybody was going to respond. But I also had put my intention and my manifestations of who I thought would sound the best on the song out there to the world. And the people who responded were the ones I wanted.
That's really cool. I had one other question before we get back to the music. So we talked a little bit about your vision loss and how throughout your life it's affected the way that you took tests as a child. And, mm-hmm. you know, I guess if you fast forward to today, again, many of the folks who are watching at home tonight are affected. They're affected with a variety of different blinding conditions. And so I'm sure that they would find it really relating to hear how what you do today is impacted by your vision loss and how it affects your day-to-day today.
I actually just wrote a lyric today. It's on my phone, which I'm now speaking on, so I can't pull it up, but it's essentially, it is the way my worldview is intentionally a bit fuzzy. And so, the song and the lyric that I'm working on is this idea that, I'm a little bit blind. My world is a little bit hazy, but I like it that way because when I do choose to really focus on something, I can see it for what it really is and how it really feels for me, as opposed to just having this, being inundated with the wall of detail that I feel completely overwhelmed when I put on my glasses sometimes, and I can see every little pore on my skin or whatever it is. Like, I don't always want that. And so I think it's allowed me to move through the world in a way where I can sense things with more intuition and not get caught up in the details, because I literally cannot see the details. And so in songwriting, that has helped me, but also in my life as a mother and as a daughter and somebody who enjoys being around my family as much as I do. And I really am such a homebody when I'm home. I can enjoy my time with my family because I'm not busy, you know, looking at the crumbs on the floor being like, why isn't this swept up? You know, I don't know. I just don't know they're there. So, sometimes life can be a bit sweeter when you really acknowledge what it is in your life that you care about and don't spend so much time focusing literally or figuratively on the details.
That's great advice. Let me intro these two songs. So Grace is going to play two songs back to back now. Two of my favorites, actually. She's going to play Every Heartbeat and Stars. And so with that, Grace Potter.
Every song I sing sounds like I'm calling to you. I'm falling harder day by day. And every word you speak, the doubts that linger in me begin to slowly fade away. I'm hoping that the morning is gonna make it here on time. 'Cause I can't wait to find you by my side. I can feel you and you can feel me. I fall deeper with every heartbeat. And when you call me, I'll come running. I fall deeper with every heartbeat. I fall deeper with every heartbeat. I tried to tell myself that I could live without you. It left me lost and so alone. So I will keep you close. Lay your head beside me. You bring me joy I've never known. And I'm hoping that the morning will make it here on time. 'Cause I can't wait to find you by my side. I can feel you and you can feel me. I fall deeper with every heartbeat. When you call me, I'll come running. I fall deeper with every heartbeat. I fall deeper with every heartbeat. Yeah. So please believe me when I say, the only sure thing is that everything will change. But I'm gonna be there waiting when you wait. And I'm hoping that the morning will make it here on time. 'Cause I can't wait to find you by my side. I can feel you and you can feel me. I fall deeper with every heartbeat. And when you call me, I'll come running. I fall deeper with every heartbeat. I fall deeper with every heartbeat. The stars, they make me wonder where you are. Stars up on Heaven's Boulevard. And if I know you at all, I know you've gone too far. So I can't look at the stars. We looked up at the sky, looking out so far, we felt like we could fly. But now I'm all alone in the dark of night. The moon is shining, but I can't see that light. And I can't look at the stars. They make me wonder where you are. Stars up on Heaven's Boulevard. And if I know you at all, I know you've gone too far. So I can't look at the stars.
Oh, that was awesome. That was great. I feel just so privileged to be here. I feel like I'm in a little personal one-person concert with you. So I feel extremely guilty for that. But I'm reminded by the fact that there are hundreds, if not thousands, of folks watching at home all sharing in this experience together. One of the songs you just played, which is my, well, I have so many of your songs that are my favorite, but one of my favorites is Every Heartbeat. And I know in that video you feature a child. And I just wonder if you share a little bit about the inspiration for that song and the writing process for it.
That song really gets me every time. I wrote it when I was pregnant with my son, Sagan. And it was really, it was a big wrapping my arms around the feeling of becoming a mother with the person that I love more than anything. So it was really kind of half for my husband, Eric, and half for this beautiful life that was growing inside me. And, you know, I always found those like what to expect when you're expecting books kind of corny. Like you can read about what's happening in your body and all that. But, you know, I've always really enjoyed feeling things because, again, reading is not actually that awesome for somebody who can't read tiny letters in books. And so I really embraced the feeling of every little kick. The first time we were able to hear his heartbeat when we went to the doctor and were able to actually confirm that the heart was going. Those are moments that it's the first time that it's ever happened to me, but it also is the last time that it will ever be the first time. And, you know, so when I can hear that and have the sensation of a human heart beating inside me that was created through the love that I feel so much for my partner, it overwhelmed me. And the song just kind of wrote itself. I mean, I cannot tell you how quickly it was written. I don't actually remember it being written. It just became a song from beginning to middle to end. So it was a really powerful one on my album Daylight, mainly because I needed some happiness. I think a lot of the album was focusing on the healing and some of the more painful sides of sense of loss and change and shift in my life. And that's really the corner turn on the album where things start to look forward and I start to look at the life I have and find myself being present and really feeling that gratitude. So yeah, that song is very, very important to me. And I'm glad that it's one of your faves too.
It's beautiful. Yeah. It's awesome. And in a real silly way, I also love the, I think it's a green guitar, like an aqua guitar that's in the video.
That's a Gretsch. Really, yep. That's a really cool. Jim Dandy. Yep.
Just awesome. But
I got that thing at a pawn shop. It had five strings instead of six. And I got it at a pawn shop in Virginia Beach when my sister had just given birth to her baby. So there's a whole link with that guitar. So for those of you who aren't able to see the video, if you go on YouTube and listen to the song, I could describe to you that basically that guitar looks the way an avocado tastes. So do with that what you will.
That's a great description. It's so perfect. So cool. When you put, I'm going to take a left turn, but you just said something that I thought was really interesting, that in the album Daylight, that song was sort of a turning point in the album. When you put together an album, do you assemble the songs to tell a story? Do you write the songs to tell a story? Does that happen organically as your songwriting? Does it happen afterwards after the song's recorded? How does that happen?
It depends on the album, because I have wrapped my head around an album as a concept before, but with this album, I didn't actually know I was writing an album at the time that I was writing these songs, I had no intention of getting back into the music industry. I was really pretty broken. My band had broken up. I had my marriage to my first husband had fallen apart, and I was really hurting for years. I took 4.5 years away from music without any intention of ever coming back. So when a lot of these songs were written, I wrote them for myself. These were journal entries that I could tuck into and were really helping me to process and understand what happened in my life and how I was able to move forward. And it was only later, especially being married to a record producer, that he heard some of those recordings And I suppose I chose to share them with him, but at some point, but I don't really remember that. I only remember like suddenly he knew about certain songs that I thought were like my little secret. And he was like, this, you know, let's expand on this. Let's explore this. You know, these are your stories, but, you tell stories in a way that only you can, and they should be shared if you're comfortable doing that. And he didn't push beyond that, but, in the process of making the album, all I knew was that I had never written music for me until the album Daylight. And that's why I think it was received as well as it was, because it was maybe the first time anybody has ever really gotten a chance to know me on that personal level. It's an incredibly intimate, terrifying album of music that is really immersive and gives you a real view from my perspective into what it's like to be me.
So on behalf of your, you know, legions of fans, so we all owe, actually, is it Eric?
Yes, Eric, yeah, Valentine.
So we all owe him a huge debt of gratitude, because that was a gift to all of us. And amazing that it happened just sort of that way.
Yeah, which is very, very organic. Great. Thank you so much.
Again, a reminder to everyone who's watching at home, and Grace, thank you for sharing so much of these personal stories and anecdotes. I know everyone is just hanging on every word and enjoying this as hopefully as much as I am. But as a reminder to everyone at home, if you'd like to learn more about what we do at the Foundation Fighting Blindness, please go to fightingblindness.org. If you'd like to donate, help support our mission, which is a critical mission. We need every dime that we could possibly raise right now to continue to push our mission forward. Please donate by clicking the button below, or you can also donate at fightingblindness.org. I had one more topic I wanted to talk a little bit about tonight. And then we've got a couple special guests that I'm excited to bring into the conversation. But if I understand correctly, you're actually touring now for the first time in a while. You're actually back out in front of live fans.
And, yes,
you know, we talked about what it was like, sort of, you know, the experience in virtual world, and then now being back out in front of fans. So what is that like, and how has that changed your approach to performing, you know, as compared to 2 years ago?
It's been profound, and it's also been a real return to form for me, because I forgot that I started out as a solo artist. We all begin as musicians. If you pick up a guitar, or if you sit down at a piano, the very first time you do that, you're alone. It's you and your relationship with the music that you hear inside you. And it's up to you to figure out how to get that music out of you. And I forgot that. I really did, because I was so busy building my village of awesome people. And these concerts that I have been putting on, they're all socially distanced and really with a focus on, you know, public safety and public healing, because music is medicine. And as you all know, everybody who's watching knows that this is how we find our life force. But also, you know, if it's not safe to do so, it makes it really hard, because we end up holding dance parties in our house by ourselves. I was dancing to Gloria this morning by myself with my son eating cereal, just looking at me like, "Mom, are you okay?" So I do think the solo shows have invited back in that person I was when I had music inside me and I had no idea how it was going to get out of me, but I knew it needed to. And it's also, again, like I discussed early on in our conversation about touching my audience in a new way and connecting with my audience in a way that felt so much more direct. I'm able to do that now because the socially distanced shows have everybody in pods where you can really see each family. You can see the gatherings of people, specifically people who maybe haven't seen each other in a year and a half or more, who are using my concert as a reason to gather for the first time. So it's like watching people come out of their chrysalis and spread their wings and become the beautiful butterflies again. And I see it over and over again in my concerts. People are just astounding to watch when they're experiencing something. It is totally different than my experience. So even though I can't see details and I can hear their laughter. Sometimes I can actually hear their conversations, which is a little weird because they're talking while I'm singing, but I actually really like it.
I'll tell you what, Grace, speaking of two beautiful butterflies, have you ever heard of two blind brothers? Brad?
I'm excited. Manning? I mean, I heard you talk about them. They make these t-shirts.
We'll send you some. So we've got a series of items that we sell at Shop Fighting Blindness. And our really good friends, Brad and Brian Manning, who are two brothers that have a condition called Stargardt's disease. And they started a clothing company that returns all of their profits to finding cures for blinding conditions through the foundation. They even have a special experience called Shopping Blind. And how this works is that you ultimately trust them to pick out awesome gear for you. And so the Shop Blind experience is a really cool way to not only help a great mission, but also to experience what it's like to be in their shoes. So let's check in on the guys. So Brad, Brian, what's up guys? How are you doing?
Hey Jason, thanks so much. Brian and I have just been so grateful to be able to be a part of this. Grace, you are absolutely amazing. You've been sort of the highlight on Brian and I's playlist now since we found out you were doing this, and a little bit before that too, but we just want to say thank you and we want to encourage everyone to, you know, keep supporting the Foundation Fighting Blindness. If you already don't know, we are living through a medical revolution. The foundation is at the cutting edge of all of that. We've been lucky to be a bigger and bigger part of helping them out and to be able to see you all do such cool things like this concert, and a big thank you to Grace as well.
Yeah, and anybody out there, I'm telling you, put Grace in your playlist. It'll put a pep in your step everywhere you go. I have a bigger smile on my face. Jason, thanks for all of the awesome, awesome hosting. And to everyone out there, thanks for supporting this incredible cause we care so dearly about. And we will get out of your way so you guys can have a little more fun.
Awesome, guys. Thank you so much. And thank you for supporting Music to Our Eyes and the Foundation Fighting Blindness. And again, for everyone at home, please be sure to check out our friends at Two Blind Brothers at www.twoblindbrothers.com. I want to sort of set this up. For everyone at home, Grace shared with me a little bit earlier that this is the first time that she's ever performed this. And so taking us home tonight, the amazing Grace Potter.
Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fear relieved. How precious did that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see.
Wow. Thank you so much, Grace. That was amazing. That really was. That was so, so beautiful. Thank you. And thank you for sharing so much of your story and your music and your passion with us tonight. And thank you to everyone at home. This was a great evening. Thanks for joining us tonight. And again, if you'd like to learn more about what we do at the Foundation Fighting Blindness, go to www.fightingblindness.org. Please support our mission by hitting the donate button below. And please support our friends at twoblindbrothers.com. Brad and Brian are our biggest cheerleaders and amazing guys. And we're so, so proud to be partnering with them to help try to find treatments and cures for blinding diseases. So anyways, thank you so much for joining us tonight. And everyone, stay safe, have a great night, and we'll talk to you soon.
This has been a presentation of Music to Our Eyes, a Foundation Fighting Blindness music series.